Would you please rise and join me as we call one another to worship using the inspired words of Psalm 47. Clap your hands, all you nations. Shout to God with cries of joy. Sing praises to God. Sing praises. Sing praises to our King. Sing praises.
For God is the King of all the earth. Sing to Him a psalm of
Jesus, the Savior, reigns. His kingdom cannot fail. Rejoice, give thanks, and sing. Praise the Lord. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. Who can utter the mighty deeds of the Lord or declare all His praise? Let us come into His presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to Him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. Lord, we come into your house, into your presence today to praise and adore you. It is you who made us, and we are yours. But sadly, we come into your house as sinners. Both we and our fathers have sinned. We have committed iniquity. We have done wickedness. We have sinned in thought and word and deed. We have sinned by what we have done and what we have left undone. And yet, despite all our faults, Lord, you so loved the world that you sent your only Son, and through his atoning work on the cross, you have reconciled us to you. He was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. The Savior reigns, Jesus. Rejoice, give thanks, and sing. We pray your blessing on all aspects of our worship today. We pray that your Spirit would be felt by those present and manifested in the actions of those leading, in Nathan and Dan and the choir as they lead us, glorifying you in music, in Tim as he leads us in raising our prayers to you, and in your servant Mark as he opens your word and teaches from your sacred scriptures. And Father, hear us now as we are led by the Holy Spirit to pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our coming day's bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into trial, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This is the part of the service where we would normally pass the peace of Christ to one another. If you are able to do so, join in the service with friends or family, please do so now. If you are not with someone, I encourage you to take this time and pray for Christ's peace for someone who you'd like to be with. May grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ our Lord. Good morning. My name is Lyford Beveridge. I'm a member of the Board of Elders here at Park Street, and it's my privilege to welcome you. I know that you'd all like to be here, and we'd like to have you all, but we're working on doing the opening as safely as we can because we want to protect and show love for one another by keeping each other healthy to the extent possible. So that time I know is coming, and we're all looking forward to it, but we'll get there when we get there. As is our custom during this period, our online bulletin is available at parkstreet.org/live, parkstreet.org/live, and I'd encourage you to open up and follow along during the service. And there are links on that page to the weekly announcements, which can also be found by going directly to parkstreet.org/announcements. And now I'd like to invite up Reverend Mark Booker.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to welcome you and add my word of greeting to Lyford's as well. We do want you to know that you're very welcome in this community, and particularly if you're new or if you've just found us online over the last several months, that we'd like to be a home for you and a place for you to be known. There are many ways to do that. One is just simply to fill out the online welcome card on our homepage, and that would allow us to follow up with you. Another way is to jump into one of our faith and practice classes that begins on September 27th, and the details for those are on the announcements page as well. The main thing I wanted to let you know about this morning is we are launching today a virtual ministry fair or ministry orientation page on our website. So in years past, we would have had our Welcome Center displayed a lot of the different ministries that we were doing and had people from those ministries to talk with you and give you an orientation to the church. We can't do that this year, so we're doing it virtually. So if you go to our announcements page, the top link is to this ministry orientation, and there's about 20 minutes of video footage from different staff detailing the kinds of ministries that we are engaged in and doing in ways that you can be involved. We'll be adding some more videos to this page in the future as well, so keep checking back. But it's a great resource, a good way to get to know more about who we are and how you might be connected to this church. Let's now continue our time together in worship.
A reading from the prophet Isaiah. See, my servant will act wisely. He will be raised and lifted up and highly exalted, just as many who were appalled at him. His appearance was so disfigured beyond that of any man, and his form marred beyond human likeness. So will he sprinkle many nations, and kings will shut their mouths because of him. For what they were not told, they will see, and what they have not heard, they will understand. Who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a tender shoot, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no beauty or majesty to attract us to him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows and familiar with suffering. Like one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearer is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By oppression and judgment he was taken away, and who can speak of his descendants? For he was cut off from the land of the living. For the transgression of my people he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked and with the rich in his death, though he had done no violence, nor was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring and prolong his days, and the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By his knowledge, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. Therefore, I will give him a portion among the great, and he will divide the spoils with the strong, because he has poured out his life unto death and was numbered with the transgressors. For he bore the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. may be seated. Today we're reading in John's Gospel. As we begin to march through John's Gospel, please join now. John chapter 1, verse 19. Now this was John's testimony. When the Jews of Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was, he did not fail to confess, but confessed freely, "I am not the Christ." They asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." Finally, they said, "Who are you? Give us an answer to take back to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" John replied in the words of Isaiah the prophet, "I am the voice of one calling in the desert, make straight the way for the Lord." Now some of the Pharisees who had been sent questioned him, "Why then do you baptize if you are not the Christ, nor Elijah, nor the prophet?" "I baptize with water," John replied, "but among you stands one you do not know. He is the one who comes after me, the thongs of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie." This all happened at Bethany on the other side of Jordan where John was baptizing. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, a man comes after me who has surpassed me because he is before me. I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony, "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him except that the one who has sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God." This is the word of the Lord.
Let's pray. Almighty God and Father, we worship you this morning and glorify your Son, Jesus. And we come longing to meet you, longing to have you speak as we open up your word. Come, O God, by the Spirit, and make yourself known to us that we might be more like your Son, Jesus. We ask this in his name and for his glory. Amen. You can be seated. There's a saying that some of you may have heard about the Gospel of John. It's often quoted. The Gospel of John is shallow enough for a child to wade in, but deep enough for an elephant to swim in. And this is attributed often to Augustine or to Spurgeon, as many memorable quotes are. But according to New Testament scholar David Turner, it likely goes back to Gregory the Great in the 6th century from his moral reflections on the book of Job. Gregory comments that Scripture stretches the minds of the wise and nourishes the minds of the simple. And then he writes about all of Scripture, that Scripture is like a river that has shallow parts where a lamb may wade and depths where an elephant may swim. The reality about the Gospel of John is not that it has shallow and deep parts like a river, but that the whole of John's Gospel is capable of communicating the truth about Jesus in simple terms, and at the same time, capable of sustaining the deepest thought and reflection of all Christians. In short, whether you are new to the faith or even just exploring Christianity, or you're a professor of New Testament, engaging the Gospel of John is always rewarding. I learned that the Gospel was good for beginners from my dad. I've mentioned before that my dad was an airline pilot, and he perfected the art of airplane evangelism. He commuted from Colorado Springs to St. Louis for the last 15 years or so of his career, and often rode in the back with the rest of us. The key tool in his arsenal, aside from an admirable storytelling ability and his gentleness, was a pocket-sized Gospel of John. After engaging with someone in a conversation, he'd end the conversation usually by asking if he could give this person a gift of this Gospel of John, and politely at times was refused, and he'd be fine with that, but for those who said they'd be glad to take it, he'd hand them a copy of the Gospel of John. And I grew up with these little pocket-sized Gospels of John around my house, and it was a reminder that this is a great book to turn to if you're exploring the faith or a beginner in your Christian life. There's a lot to glean from John. We're titling the series Come and See because this gospel is an invitation to come and see Jesus, the one who explains God to us. That's what verse 18 says in John 1, the prologue. Jesus exegetes the Father to us. He is God's autobiography, so that Jesus can say to his disciples in John 14, whoever has seen me has seen the Father. If you're not yet sure about Jesus, if you're tuning in online today hoping that none of your roommates or family members will see you because if they did, they'd wonder why you were interested in something called church or in something called Christianity, then this is a great book for you. It's a great book to dig into. You'll see Jesus clearly portrayed, which means that you will see God as God longs for himself to be known. And John the Evangelist, who writes this gospel, writes with a very specific purpose. He's very explicit at the end of the gospel in John 20, verse 31. But these are written, he says, that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. That's why this gospel exists, John says, because I want you to see Jesus, and I want you in seeing Jesus to come to entrust yourself to him and to have life, to know life. Eternal life is a theme of this gospel, this life that never ends, that God alone can give. But this is also a book for more mature Christians, for those perhaps who've been walking with Jesus for some time. John's simple writing style, his Greek is the simplest of the New Testament, should not be mistaken for any lack of profound thought or depth. In fact, we all know that the use of big words can often actually conceal a confused mind or a lack of understanding. I heard someone say that his teacher in theology at Cambridge taught him never to use a three-syllable word when a two-syllable word would do. And that's a great lesson, I think, for all students and for all of us. There is a sense in which John embodies that advice. He writes in a straightforward fashion, but does so with a brilliance and clarity and depth that communicates wonderfully. The elephants can swim indeed in his waters. Two ministry colleagues and I had the privilege in 2006, I was in Washington, D.C. at the time, of getting to have dinner with Tom and Maggie Wright. That's N.T. Wright. I'm sure many of you have read his work, one of the leading New Testament theologians of our day and biblical scholars. And his work up to that point especially had largely been focused on the synoptic gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. His big book, Jesus and the Victory of God, essentially just doesn't deal with the Gospel of John. So I asked him that question over dinner. I said, so when are you going to deal with the Gospel of John? And I'll never forget his response. He said, John is for mature theologians. The implication is that he wasn't ready and he wasn't yet mature enough to tackle that. He's done a bit more since then. It's 14 years ago now. But it does give me a humble pause as we start this series together. It's a wonderful book, but deep. And yet it's also a great invitation because here in John, we come to profound depths about our Lord Jesus. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. What an incredible mystery and reality that John makes plain for us in his prologue. It's interesting in the history of the study of the four Gospels, in the history of the church, they have been assigned to one of the faces of each of the four living creatures in Ezekiel's vision of heavenly glory in Ezekiel chapter 1. There's the human being, the lion, the ox, and the eagle. And John is assigned to the eagle, in part because he sees beyond and through what is immediately present to what is deeper and true. John's gospel takes the very earthy words and stories of Jesus and plumbs their depths And then here, in that case, John is a feast for all of us, newcomer and seasoned biblical scholar alike. Let me say a word about our approach. You'll notice that we are beginning today in verse 19 of chapter 1, which is not the beginning of the gospel. That means that we are jumping over the prologue, at least for the time being, so that we can begin with the narrative itself. This enables us to get right into the stories, these earthy stories of Jesus and his words and deeds, and of course of his interactions with others. We will, of course, as we look at these stories, assume the profound truths of the prologue as we move through them. And then our plan is, in the season of Advent, which starts with the last Sunday in November, the four Sundays leading up to Christmas, to return, Lord willing, to spend 4 weeks in this wonderful prologue of 18 verses. And my hope is that having spent some time with Jesus in his life and deeds already, that we will then bring added depth to our study of the prologue during Advent. One final introductory remark. The Christian life is all about Jesus. There was a time in our family when our kids were younger, when our son, who was about two or three, at any of our family devotions, we'd read something in Scripture and ask the kids some questions, and he wouldn't wait. He never hesitated. We'd ask a question, and he would just pipe up and go, "Jesus, Jesus." It was always the answer. And there's something wonderfully true about that toddler insight, that any question in Christian theology eventually takes us to Jesus, who is God's yes. All of God's promises are yes, Paul says, in Christ Jesus. Jesus is the one who is to be lifted up above all. He is the living water. He is the bread of life. He is the good shepherd, the resurrection and the life. He is the king who rules over all. All of these things are portrayed in the book of the Gospel of John. Jesus is everything. And if in the Christian life we lose sight of Jesus, then we have lost sight of everything. We've lost sight of God. We are to keep our eyes fixed on Jesus. And my hope as we take up this series is that we would come and see Jesus, whether that's for the first time or for the thousandth time, that we would, as the author of Hebrews says, keep our eyes, let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith. And in so doing, that we would be challenged and that we would grow and that we would be changed to become more like him and to know this eternal life in deeper ways. So the narrative of John the Evangelist opens up with John the Baptist and his testimony or his witness in verse 19. Now this was John's testimony. John the Baptist's testimony contains two basic messages. First, verses 19 through 28, addressing the question, who am I? And second, in verses 29 to 34, addressing the question, who is Jesus? Who am I? Who is Jesus? There are no more basic questions for us to wrestle with one another and as human beings than these two questions. And it's no surprise that as John gets his story started, that he begins here, tackling these two questions. And that's what we're going to do in the remainder of our time this morning. So first, who am I? Verses 19 through 28. John's reflection on this question is prompted by the arrival of priests and Levites sent from Jerusalem, from the Jews there in Jerusalem. And they ask him in verse 19, who are you? These were the religious professionals representing the religious authorities who were responsible for religious purity and doctrinal orthodoxy throughout Israel. And they were sent to John the Baptist as an interrogation squad because John's ministry had begun to gain some traction and it had caught their attention, and they rightly come to investigate and interrogate him, probably also to shut him down if they think that he's not legitimate and authorized to do what he's doing. So they're asking an important question, who are you? And I want to say before we look at John the Baptist's response, that we need to recognize that John the Evangelist's story, the Gospel of John, is a story that's embedded in a particular history about a particular people at a particular place, at a particular moment in time. John tells his story of Jesus, as do all the gospel writers, as the fulfillment of the Jewish story, the story about God and Israel, about Israel's great hope and God's promises that had not yet been fulfilled. It's a story that extends all the way back to creation And John lets us know that he's writing his story to reflect and respond to that great story by beginning his gospel with the words, "In the beginning." That story of God and creation, or God and humanity, gets focused in Genesis 12 on the story of God and Abram, who becomes Abraham, God and the people of Israel. They were elected, they were chosen, that through them all the nations of the earth would be blessed. This is how God would undo the problem of sin in Genesis 3, through his calling of Abram and his descendants to be agents of blessing to all the world. And these bigger stories, we need to keep them in mind, God and Israel, God and humanity, God and creation, as we take up the Gospels. To go back to the image of a child waiting, we can benefit greatly from the Gospels without much knowledge of the backstory. But that's a bit like reading the third book in a trilogy without reading the prior two. You can get a lot out of it, you can enjoy the story, but there's a lot of dimensions that you're missing because you haven't read the first two books. To swim in the depths of the Gospel of John, which takes us a lifetime, and which I hope we'll do somewhat together in this series, will mean being attentive to these much larger stories, of which John's story of Jesus is the great fulfillment and climax. This interrogation squad comes from Jerusalem because of this larger story, this Jewish story. They were awaiting the renewal of God in the world. They were awaiting God's return to Zion to set his people free and to set up his rightful rule. And so they hear of this prophet, this voice, this person baptizing out in the wilderness, and they come and they want to know, what is it that he's saying? He's not painting on a blank canvas. Instead, John the Baptist, just like Jesus, is building on a base, on outlines and expectations and tensions that are already there. And the coming of Jesus into this story is like the final bold strokes of an artist that bring a painting to its full beauty and its radiant glory. "Who are you?" they ask. John's main point in his response to this interrogation is a great lesson to learn, as every follower of Jesus should learn. It is to get out of the way. John continually points away from himself. "Who are you?" "I am not the Christ," he says in verse 20. He confesses this freely, and one can almost imagine gladly. "That's not who I am." The Christ means the Messiah, the anointed one. And the Jews of that day were looking for the Messiah's coming, the one who would fulfill the great promises of God to his people and who would reestablish the temple's former glory. And John says, "No, it's not me." The first great reality of our lives is to get this message of John hammered into our heads. We are not the Christ. At the beginning of his book, The Denial of Death, written in 1973, Ernest Becker quotes William James, who remarked, quote, "Mankind's common instinct for reality has always held the world to be essentially a theater for heroism." Becker then goes on to suggest what is in the heart of the creature is, quote, "the desire to stand out, to be the one in creation." John's message, John the Baptist's answer, moves against all that. He says, "We're not the Christ. I am not the Christ." That's what he says. And there is much that must be clear in our hearts about this if we are to engage the Christian life at all. We are not the Christ. That question of who I am cannot cast us as the hero, the central figure, the actor in a leading role. We are at best actors in a supporting role whose job it is to lift up the great hero and the protagonist, the one in the leading role, that is Jesus himself. And that's what John teaches us in his simple confession. "I am not the Christ." His interrogators press further. "Then who are you?" they ask. "Are you Elijah?" And it should be said that the Jewish people were expecting the return of Elijah, or one in the spirit and power of Elijah, to precede God's renewing work. Malachi 4:5 says, "See, I will send you the prophet Elijah before the great and dreadful day of the Lord comes." This Elijah figure would precede the renewal of God. And John the Baptist gives his second negative response, simply saying, "I am not." His denial here is a bit more challenging because Jesus in Matthew 12 says that if you are willing to accept it, that John the Baptist is the Elijah who was to come. And it is quite possible to reconcile this seeming tension on the surface by suggesting, following C.F.D. Moule, that John humbly rejected the exalted title but Jesus rightly bestowed it on him. John had such humility, as we'll see in just a moment, that he wouldn't take that on himself. But Jesus has a much greater right to bestow it upon John, that in fact he was the Elijah to come. The interrogators continue, "Are you the prophet?" Pointing back to Deuteronomy 18, there would be a prophet like Moses to whom the people of God were to listen. And this had begun, this prophecy had been wrapped up in the messianic expectations of the day. And so they asked John, "Are you the prophet? Perhaps this is who you are." And John's answer is even shorter, "No." He goes from, "I am not the Christ, I am not," to "No." As if you're missing the point, those of you asking this question. It's not about me. I'm not the one. So who are you, really, John the Baptist? What do you say about yourself? And he gives three affirmations that are helpful even to us. First, in verse 22, he quotes Isaiah 40, verse 3. "I am the voice of one calling in the desert, make straight the way for the Lord." These words, of course, are rooted in a section of Isaiah that perhaps more than any other section of the Old Testament undergirds the story of Jesus and all that he accomplishes and the great renewal. That's a passage in Isaiah that's anticipating the renewal of God, the new wine, the blessing, the life that God will bring, the new creation. And this is right from the beginning, the voice of one crying in the desert, "Make straight the way for the Lord." John the Baptist is saying, "Yes, I do have a part to play in this, but I'm just the voice. I'm just the messenger. I'm just pointing to the one who will come after me." And then he says in verse 26, "I am the water baptizer." They ask him the question, "Why do you baptize with water if you're not the Christ or you're not Elijah and you're not the prophet?" And John doesn't really answer the question. He just says, I do baptize with water, but there is one standing among you whom you do not know." The Pharisees were the ones who asked him that question about baptism. They were blinded by their zeal. We think of Saul, later called Paul, who didn't know Jesus and was persecuting him despite his zeal for the law of God. John seems to be saying, "He's standing among you, but you don't see him." That's what's important here. Not the fact that I baptize with water, but that there is this one that you don't know standing among you. His final point that he makes about himself is, "I am unworthy. I'm not worthy even to untie the straps of his sandals," the place of a servant, a very low servant. John says, "I don't even deserve that place or that position in relation to this one who's standing among you. I am not worthy." It's not about me, John says. I am not the Christ, but I am a voice who is pointing towards someone else. Paul says in 2 Corinthians 4, verse 5, "For we proclaim not ourselves, but Jesus Christ as Lord, with ourselves as your servants for Jesus' sake." This is the lesson that John teaches us about that question, "Who am I?" I am not the Christ, but I am pointing. I was created. You were created. All of us were created to point to the glory of another. We were created to manifest the glory of God through the gifts and particular stories that God has given us in our lives. We were created to point to him. And that's what John teaches us in his response to those who come. We all know how awkward it is when we've come to an event to hear a speaker and the person who is introducing the speaker tries to draw attention to him or herself. It just doesn't fit. It doesn't feel right. It's not right. And in the similar fashion, John is saying, "Look, I'm just the one introducing, the person who's here to be the plenary. It's about him." And that's a model for Christian discipleship, and it's a model for our lives. This brings us to the second question. Who is Jesus? Verses 29 through 34. And this, of course, is the far more important question. This is the question that occupies John's gospel in its entirety and that especially occupies his opening chapter. The prologue, of course, is full of these deep truths about the person of the Word, who is Jesus. But it's interesting to note that from verse 19 to the end of the chapter, this beginning of the narrative, we have more names for Jesus given in these verses than anywhere else in the New Testament, stacked on top of one another. It's as if John, the evangelist, is saying to us, "Look, this is what matters. You need to know who Jesus is. This is what matters above all." So John the Baptist, on the next day, in verse 29, gives what we would call his Jesus-defining sermon. And I should note that this sermon is initiated by Jesus himself, because if you look in verse 29, it's Jesus who was coming toward John. And I think there's a beautiful little hint here about the centrality of the divine initiative and divine grace in the life of Christian discipleship. God moves first. God steps in first. God is the one who makes himself known. God enables us to respond with belief or faith. In fact, John the Baptist says in verse 31 and in verse 33 that he himself did not know this one who was coming after him. It's beautiful, kind of a, John had tremendous zeal, tremendous insight, tremendous charisma. People were coming to him from all over. And yet he says, I was the one who was ignorant. I didn't know until God spoke in verse 33 to me. Revelation is divine grace. God's movement is first. We can know God because he has made himself known. Jesus is coming toward John the Baptist, inaugurates John the Baptist's witness to Jesus, which now we see in three primary declarations in verses 29 to 34. The central one, because it's first and because it's repeated again in verse 36, behold, or look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We can't help but see the cross. In these first words in the narrative about Jesus, we hear about his end, where he's going, where he's heading. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. There are a number of possible backgrounds for this phrase, the Lamb of God. One is the apocalyptic warrior lamb who features in the book of Revelation, another book attributed to John, and who is referenced in a couple of intertestamental texts that the Jewish people of that day would have been very familiar with. And this apocalyptic lamb overthrows the enemies of God. There is the Passover lamb of Exodus 12, slain and sacrificed in order that the people of God might be spared from death and delivered out of bondage and brought into freedom. There's the suffering servant lamb of Isaiah 53 that we read earlier in the service, described as a lamb led to the slaughter. And there are the twice daily burnt offering lambs in the temple in Exodus 29, 38 and following, which are connected to God's glory dwelling among his people. All of these backgrounds point to dealing with sin. Sin is what holds us captive. Sin is our great enemy, the one holding us in bondage. Sin renders us guilty, making us dirty. And the Lamb of God will be the agent of sin's defeat and removal, and not just for Israel, but for the world. That is, there is no one who is beyond the reach of the sin-removing work of this Lamb of God. A sin-removing work that, of course, is accomplished in its greatest manifestation at the cross, where Jesus, in being on the cross, says at the end of John's gospel, it is finished. I've done it. This is over. The work is done. The Lamb of God has been slain and taken away the sin of the world to atone for sin and to defeat sin. So 1 John 3:5, you know that he appeared in order to take away sins. This is the work of Jesus. This is the great news of the gospel. And it's here in the very first words about Jesus in the Gospel of John, on the lips of John the Baptist. One of the things that this means is that Jesus cannot be understood as simply a great teacher. We are, of course, mesmerized by his amazing teaching. But Jesus came to do more than to teach us. He came to defeat and take away sin, evil, and death by bearing them upon himself as our substitute on the cross as the Lamb of God. That's why all the Gospels, and John is no exception, build toward the story of the passion of Jesus as he comes to his death and, of course, then his subsequent resurrection. This is what defines his mission and his person. And this is why we can't be attracted only to his teaching, but we are to understand the logic and wonder of his salvific work on the cross. The corollary of this, of course, is that for us as human beings, our great problem is not ignorance, but sin. We don't just need good teaching or better learning or the triumph of reason. We cannot think our way out of our predicament. Sin binds us and distorts us and diminishes us. Thanks be to God for the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is why he came. And this is what he accomplished at the cross. And all of this is, in a sense, there in somewhat nascent form in John's first confession about the identity of Jesus. His second declaration about Jesus is in verses 32 and 33. Jesus is the one on whom the Spirit as a dove descends and remains. He is the one who gives the Spirit to others. That is, he baptizes with the Holy Spirit, as John says. And this Spirit descending upon Jesus as a dove and remaining upon him is a sure indicator of the messianic hope of the prophet Isaiah that is coming to pass and to fulfillment now in Jesus. There are many texts in Isaiah 11, Isaiah 42, and Isaiah 61 that refer to the Spirit descending and being and coming upon the servant of God, the long-awaited Son of David, who would liberate God's people. Jesus quotes Isaiah 61, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because the Lord has anointed me," in Luke chapter 4 at the opening of his ministry in Luke's gospel. But not only is Jesus the one on whom the Spirit descends and remains, but Jesus is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. That is, Jesus does not just remove sin, bringing forgiveness and liberating us from its bondage and power, but Jesus also pours out life. He empowers us by giving us the Spirit, giving us life itself. John's third and final statement about Jesus has to do with the person of Jesus. Who is the one who could do this sin-removing work and the Spirit-giving work? What is it about his person? And he says, "I have seen and I testify that this is the Son of God." The one who accomplishes this forgiving and empowering work is none other than God's eternal Son. And the expression "the Son of God" has lots of layers of meaning. It points to Israel, who was known as the Son of God. And Jesus represents, or is the corporate embodiment of Israel in a person. It points to Israel's expected Messiah in Psalm 2 that is the Son, the one whom the Lord has begotten. This was also a title used of the emperors in the Greco-Roman Empire. They were known as the Son of God, implying political and kingly connotations. But then, of course, in John's gospel, this phrase, "Son of God," has such a deep meaning that this is God's eternal Son, the Word, the one who shares in the divine identity with his Father, the one who represents Yahweh returning to his people to Zion to set them free. That is, the person of Jesus is John's third contribution here, is the reason that Jesus can accomplish the sin-bearing work of the Lamb and the Spirit-giving work of empowerment to life. Because Jesus embodies God himself among his people. You know, we have our own ways of dealing with sin. We attempt to do this in our own lives. One of them is to ignore sin and to deny that it exists. It may be that you're listening in and thinking, "I don't even know what to think about this thing called sin." The European intellectuals of the late 19th and early 20th century worked hard to build a more just society, what we would call in some ways the welfare state, and they sought to build a more just world. And they did some good work in that, but they all were united in a common belief in the goodness of humanity. Beatrice Webb was a British member of those intellectuals, a thinker, an economist, a sociologist, and she, reflecting back in the 1920s on the optimism of the late 1800s, said this. She said, "In my diary in 1890, I wrote, 'I have staked all on the essential goodness of human nature.'" And she continues, "Now, 35 years later, I realize how permanent are the evil impulses and instincts in man, and how little you can count on changing them by any change in the social machinery. No amount of knowledge or science," she says, "will prevail unless we can curb the bad impulse." You can ignore it, you can deny it, and certainly Beatrice did, as did her colleagues, but she comes to this realization. Sooner or later, you begin to see and to understand that there is an evil impulse inside of humanity that continues to manifest itself, regardless of how we try to push it down. It continues to pop itself back up. And she said, honestly, until that impulse is curbed, we have little hope. Science and knowledge cannot get us out. So we can ignore it or deny it, but eventually we have to come to terms that it's there, or we can work hard to overcome it. Some of us live with a sense of we're broken, and we know that that's true. We live with a sense of not being who we know that we should be. That's a very common human experience. And often what our response to that is I'll just try harder. I'll just make different New Year's resolutions this year. I'll just work a little bit more and make this happen. But eventually that gets exhausting and crushes us, and we can feel deeply hopeless. E. Stanley Jones was a missionary to India, a Methodist missionary in the early 20th century. And a young Jain student wrote to him. Jainism, one of its key principles as a religion is that true perception, true and right knowledge, and true and right conduct are the key to liberation. And this is what that young student of this religion said to E. Stanley Jones. "I have deep faith in my own religion," he said. "I believe it to be entirely true, but I need not be ashamed to tell that it exacts unflinching duty and knows no grace. Philosophically, it is all right. You may believe according to it that the power behind all things is supremely just and indifferent, but we err, we know not why. We are led on, as it were, on the waves of sin and mistakes. There are powers too great for our frail being, and I wish then that there were a God who would be kind to me, who would feel my weaknesses, and who would extricate me from the meshes of sin and temptation. Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world is good news for every human being that is struggling under the weight of his own imperfections or her own sins, who is living with a sense of guilt and shame and knowing that we could be more than we are, but we continue to fall short. What John proclaims about Jesus in his opening words is that this Jesus has dealt with that problem that we can never get out of through more learning, through the triumph of reason, through any of our own efforts or attempts. And that is wonderful news. Only God could do that. Or we try to get life, the other great thing that Jesus brings, not just the removal of sin, but the giving of the Spirit, the empowerment of each of us as human beings to know life. We try in all kinds of ways, through success or knowledge or pleasure. The list goes on and on. But when we're honest, we know that those things, and this is a message throughout the Gospel of John, that those things cannot give what they promise. They lead to emptiness. Thanks be to God for the one on whom the Spirit descends, who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. We can't deal with sin on our own. We can't give life or bring life on our own. And this is why John the Baptist's lesson to all of us is so critical and so important. I am not the Christ. I am a pointer, a voice. We are all pointers and voices. Humanity operating the way it's meant and created to operate is humanity that is constantly reflecting glory back to our Creator, the one who alone can give life, the one who alone can remove and take away and defeat and liberate us from the problem of sin that all of us so deeply feel. And that's why John the Baptist teaches us, and John the Evangelist through John the Baptist teaches us, to keep pointing to him. Point to him. Who am I? It doesn't really matter. I'm a voice. I am a part of this great creation that God has made to reflect back to my Creator. Who is he? He is the one who deals with my problem. He is the one who gives me life. And he is the Son of God who alone can do this, God in the flesh, who can do the work that I desperately long to have done. Come and see. My prayer is that we'll come and see this Jesus more and more as we work through this gospel together, to see the one who does deal with sin and to see the one who truly brings life. This is the great Christian hope. This is why we constantly say, in response to every question, to every inquiry, Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, the one who baptizes with the Spirit. He is our life. He is our hope. He is our Lord. Let's pray. Oh God, we cry out to you to help us see Jesus in our lives. We still have a need for his work to remove sin, to give life. And I pray today that for all of us, that you would pierce through the distraction, the darkness, the guilt and shame, the pride and ego, whatever it is that's blocking us from you, that we might see Jesus. How we thank you and praise you for dealing with our great problem and for giving us what we deeply long for. We honor you and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Seated. My name is Tim Leary. I'm the Director of Graduate Student Ministries. Next week is University Sunday, so if you're an undergrad, graduate, or faculty, we're going to have things for you. Faculty will have a Zoom meeting at 10 a.m. Graduate students will have a reception right after this, a Zoom reception. And for undergrads, they actually have one every week and including this week, right after the service, so look online for that. Now we're going to have a testimony from a family of our church and how they're getting on with following Jesus during this crazy time.
I'm a neurologist at the Massachusetts General Hospital, and we've been members of Park Street Church for 9 years.
I am Freya, and I'm 8.5 years old, and I'm a twin.
I am Sylvie, I'm 8.5 years old, and we're going into third grade.
I'm Liv, I'm 11, and I'm going into sixth grade, and we three go to the Ruff and Ridley School in Brookline.
I'm Erica Anderson, I am a part-time lawyer and mom to these three.
We got the idea for the Lost and Found jars from our friend and fellow Park Streeter, Mary Frances Giles. She told me that she and her roommate did it, and it really resonated with me because I found myself struggling early on in the pandemic with spiraling into almost a sense of depression of all the things that we had lost, and so abruptly. There was really no notice other than one day the kids were going to school and we were going into our offices, and the next day everything came to a screeching halt and we were all at home together.
Getting to meet my teacher in person, lost.
And it struck me when we explained to the girls what we were doing, and they helped make our little salsa jars, our empty salsa jars, into our Lost and Found jars, how naturally it came to them. How they very quickly wrote down things that they had lost and that they missed, their friends from school, being able to play basketball or soccer, getting to go into their classrooms every single day. But they also immediately started filling our found jar. They immediately saw the regular game nights that we were doing as a family, the regular movie nights, the ways that we had adjusted to change things so that it wasn't all loss in a pandemic.
Sleeping in, found.
And while I knew that being at home together was kind of a gift, and there were so many things I loved about it, the not having to pull the kids out of bed and hurry, 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 get ready for school and out the door, there were also so many things that we were mourning, from the kids losing a pajama day at school to the Boston Marathon, which I had been training for when the pandemic hit, no longer being on the calendar.
There was a stretch of time where the losses seemed to be mounting. A music festival that we attend every summer getting canceled, or a work trip I was really looking forward to not happening.
School, lost.
Not getting haircuts with our aunt, lost.
When I think about the lost and found jars, I think about in the Bible, a lot of the times you hear that people who are suffering are usually closer to God. And I think that the lost and found jars help us so that in the midst of a dark time and when we're suffering, that we can, that it's easier for us to see what God is doing in our lives.
So the idea of thinking about things as lost and found resonated with me because it gave us language to talk about what we were missing, what we no longer had because of the pandemic. But it also gave us language to look at what are some of the new things that we now have, that we have found, that we wouldn't have had but for the pandemic.
Found jar is that when you find something you lose, then you can also find something that you found because you lost that thing. For an example, we didn't have any summer camps, but we had a very long vacation in Maine.
Getting a haircut with Chanel.
When I looked at the losses in totality, I'll have to be honest, a lot of them were fairly superficial and temporary. Whereas if I look at the finds, like increased time with family or having a greater calling for my work as a physician, these were meaningful and more long-lasting.
Going to Maine. Found.
I think of the story of Jesus and Mary and Martha and Lazarus. And when he came to the house and he found the sisters crying and lamenting and sad, and rightfully so, because they lost their brother, Jesus didn't skip to the, but I'm going to raise him from the dead, he's going to be back. Jesus sat down with them and he wept. He suffered their loss with them. I think sometimes as Christians, we forget the lament part and we are so quick to want to jump to the silver lining. We're quick to want to say, but here's the good, here's the joy, here's the hope. And those are all good things and that's all right. But the joy and the hope is most meaningful because we know of the darkness, we know of the sadness. The resurrection is the more glorious because of the death, because of the cross. And if we just skip over the lamenting part, the sadness, the loss, we can't fully appreciate the joy and the glory of all the ways that God has blessed us with many, many good things.
I also have to think of, well, God is still doing really, really good things right now and is being helping me through this time right now.
And it has provided really good context for me as this pandemic wears on. Because the loss doesn't have an end right now. And we find ourselves sometimes thinking, or I find myself thinking like the psalmist, how long, God? How long? How long are we going to do this? How long are the kids going to be at home from school and we're going to be balancing work and school? But I also find myself saying, how much longer do we get to do this as a family? How much longer do we have this special time of very few commitments on our calendar and we're not racing off to all these different activities? And that's the part that is a real blessing to me and one that I want to continue to hold on to even when this pandemic finally does end.
Let's pray together now. Lord God, you are the creator of the whole world. Lord, you know how long this trying time will be. Help us follow you, Jesus, during this tough time. Lord, we pray for your mercy on this world. We pray for our missionaries throughout the world serving at a difficult time. We pray that you minister to them, minister to their families, help their ministry, help their sacrifice in missions bring glory to you. We pray for success in their church planting and their outreach to youth, in their Bible translations. We pray that you'd be with them. But Lord, here in Boston, we also pray for mercy and grace. Lord, the many students that are going back to school, children that are going to school for the first time this week, college students that have returned, university students, graduate students, and faculty, we pray for the teachers. We pray for safety. Lord, help us as we transition. We pray for this church. Help the leaders know when to do what as we regroup and try to worship you this fall. We pray that you'd speak to us through the Gospel of John. Lord, help it come alive to our ears and our hearts. Lord, we pray that one day we'd be the ones giving out John Gospels to those near us and as we travel. Help us, Lord God, worship you here today and this week. Help us worship you as we look forward to University Sunday next week. Help us love you in our community, at work or at home. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's now continue our time of worship as we listen to beautiful music and give sacrificially to the Lord's work. You can do that now online. Amen.
Thank you.
just before the benediction, I do want to encourage you to be a part of a Sunday worship community. And I especially want to mention to you that our students who have become or who are new to the city, that there are two student Sunday worship communities meeting, one after this service and one after the 4 p.m. service. The link is on the announcements page. And finally, there's a prayer gathering tonight for everyone in the church who would like to join in on Zoom at 7 o'clock. Now receive the benediction. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.